द कंप्लीट वर्क्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंदा प्रैक्टिकल वेदांता द वे टू द रियलाइजेशन ऑफ अ यूनिवर्सल रिलीजन पार्ट वन नो सर्च हैज बीन डियरर टू द ह्यूमन हार्ट देन दैट विच हैज ब्रॉट अस लाइट फ्रॉम गॉड नो स्टडी हैज टेकन सो मच ऑफ ह्यूमन एनर्जी वेदर इन टाइम्स ऑफ पास्ट और प्रेजेंट हैज द स्टडी of the soul, of God and of human destiny. However immersed we are in our daily occupations, in our ambitions, in our work, in the midst of the greatest of our struggles, sometimes there will come a pause, the mind stops and wants to know something beyond this world. Sometimes it catches glimpses of the realm beyond the senses, and a struggle to get at it is the result. Thus, it has been throughout the ages in all countries. Man has wanted to look beyond, wanted to expand himself, and all that we call progress, evolution, has been always measured by that one search, the search for human destiny, the search for God. As our social struggles are represented amongst different nations, by different social organizations, so also is man's spiritual struggle represented by various religions. And as different social organizations are constantly quarreling, are constantly at war with each other, so also these spiritual organizations have been constantly at war with one another, constantly quarreling. Men belonging to a particular social organization claim that the right to live only belongs to them. And so long as they can, they want to exercise that right at the cost of the weak. We know that just now there is a fierce struggle of that sort going on in South Africa. Similarly, each religious sect has claimed the exclusive right to live. And thus we find that though there is nothing that has brought to man more blessings than religion, yet at the same time there is nothing that has brought more horror than religion. Nothing has brought more for peace and love than religion. Nothing has engendered fiercer hatred than religion. Nothing has made the brotherhood of man more tangible than religion. Nothing has bred more enmity between man and man than religion. Nothing has built more charitable institutions, more hospitals for men and even for animals than religion. Nothing has deluged this world with more blood than religion. We know at the same time that there has always been an undercurrent of thought. There have been always parties of men, philosophers, students of comparative religion who have tried and are still trying to bring about harmony in the midst of all these jarring and discordant sects. As regards certain countries, these attempts have succeeded, but as regards the whole world, they have failed. There are some religions which have come down to us from the remotest antiquity, which are imbued with the idea that all sects should be allowed to live, that every sect has a meaning, a great idea embedded within itself, and therefore it is necessary for the good of the world and ought to be held. In modern times, the same idea is prevailing and attempts are made from time to time to reduce it to practice. These attempts do not always come up to our own expectations, up to the required level of efficiency. Nay, to our great disappointment, we sometimes find that we are quarreling all the more. Now, leaving aside dogmatic study and taking a common sense view of the thing, we find at the start that there is a tremendous life power in all the great religions of the world. Some may say that they are ignorant of this, but ignorance is no excuse. If a man says, I do not know what is going on in the external world, therefore things that are going on in the external world do not exist for me, that man is inexcusable. Now those of you that watch the movement of the religious thought all over the world are perfectly aware that not one of the great religions of the world has died. Not only so, each one of them is progressive. Christians are multiplying, Mohammedans are multiplying, the Hindus are gaining ground, and the Jews are also increasing. But by their spreading all over the world and increasing rapidly, the fold of Judaism is constantly expanding. Only one religion in the world, an ancient great religion, has dwindled away, and that is the religion of Zoroastrianism, the religion of the ancient Persians. Under the Mohammedan conquest of Persia, about 100,000 of these people came and took shelter in India, and some remained in ancient Persia. Those that were in Persia are under the constant persecution of the Mohammedans, dwindled down till there are at most only 10,000. In India there are about 80,000 of them, but they do not increase. Of course, there is an individual difficulty. They do not convert others to their religion. And then, this handful of persons living in India with the pernicious custom of cousin marriage do not multiply. With this single exception, all the great religions are living, spreading, and increasing. We must remember that all the great religions of the world are very ancient. Not one has been formed at the present time. And that every religion of the world owes its origin to the country between the Ganga and the Euphrates. Not one great religion has arisen in Europe, not one in America, not one. Every religion is of Asiatic origin and belongs to that part of the world. If what the modern scientists say is true, that the survival of the fittest is the test, these religions prove by their still living that they are yet to fit some people. There is a reason why they should live. They should bring good to many. Look at the Mohammedans, how they are spreading in some places in southern Asia and spreading like fire in Africa. The Buddhists are spreading all over Central Asia all the time. The Hindus, like the Jews, do not convert others. Still, gradually, other races are coming within Hinduism and adopting the manners and customs of the Hindus and falling into line with them. Christianity, you all know, is spreading. Though I am not sure that the results are equal to the energy put forth, the Christian attempt at propaganda has one tremendous effect, one tremendous defect, and that is the defect of all the Western institutions. The machinery consumes 90% of the energy. There is too much machinery. Preaching has always been the business of the Asiatics. The Western people are grand in organization, social institutions, armies, governments, etc. But when it comes to preaching religion, they cannot come near the Asiatic, whose business it has been all the time. And he knows it. He does not use too much machinery. Then this is a fact. In the great present history of the human race, that all the great religions exist and are spreading and multiplying. Now there is a meaning certainly to this. And had it been the will of an all-wise and all-merciful creator that one of these religions should exist and the rest should die, it would have become a fact long ago. If it were a fact that only one of these religions is true and all the rest are false, by this time it would have covered the whole ground. But this is not so. Not one has gained all the ground. All religions sometimes advance, sometimes decline. Now just think of this. In your own country, there are more than 60 million of people, and only 21 million profess religions of all sorts. So it is not always progress. In every country, probably if the statistics are taken, you will find that religions are sometimes progressing and sometimes going back. Sects are multiplying all the time. If the claims of a religion that it has all the truth and God has given it all this truth in a certain book were true, then why are there so many sects? 50 years do not pass before there are 20 sects found upon the same book. If God has put all the truth in certain books, He does not give us those books in order that we may not quarrel over texts. That seems to be the fact. But why is it? Even if a book were given by God which contained all the truth about religion, it would not serve the purpose because nobody would be able to understand that book. Take the Bible for instance, and all the sects that exist among the Christians. Each one puts upon itself its own interpretation of that same text, and each says that it alone understands that text and the rest are all wrong. So it is with every religion. There are many sects among the Mohammedans and among the Buddhists and hundreds among the Hindus. Now I bring these facts before you in order to show to you that any attempt to bring all humanity to one method of thinking in spiritual things has been a failure and always will be a failure. Every man starts with a theory. Even at the present day, finds that if he goes 20 miles away from his followers, they will make 20 sects. You see that happening all the time. You cannot make all conform to the same ideas. That is a fact, and I thank God that it is so. I am not against any sect. I am glad that sects exist. And I only wish that they may go on multiplying more and more. Why? Simply because of this. If you and I and all who are present here were to think exactly the same thoughts, there would be no thoughts for us to think. We know that two or more forces must come into collision in order to produce motion. It is the clash of thought, the differentiation of thought, that awakens thought. Now, if we all thought alike, we would be like Egyptian mummies in a museum, looking vacantly at all other faces. No more than that. Whirls and eddies occur only in a rushing living stream. There are no whirlpools in stagnant dead water. When all religions are dead, there will be no more sects. There will be the perfect peace and harmony of the grave. But so long as mankind thinks, there will be sects. Variation is a sign of life. It must be there. I pray that there may multiply so long as last there may be sects as human beings, and each one of will have his own method, his individual method of thought in religion. But this thing exists already. Each one of us is thinking in his own way. But his natural course has been obstructed all the time and is still being obstructed. If the sword is not used directly, other means will be used. Just hear what one of the best preachers in New York says. He preaches that the Filipinos should be conquered because that is the only way to teach Christianity to them. they are already Catholics, but he wants to make them Presbyterians, and by this he is ready to lay all his terrible sin of bloodshed upon his race. How terrible! And this man is one of the greatest preachers of this country, one of the best informed men. Think of the state of the world when a man like that is not ashamed to stand up and utter such errant nonsense. And think of the state of the world when an audience cheers him. Is this civilization? It is the old bloodthirstiness of the tiger, the cannibal, the savage, coming out once more under new names, new circumstances. What else can it be? If the state of things is such now, think of the horrors through which the world has passed in olden times, when every sect was trying by every means in its power to tear to pieces the other sects. History shows that the tiger in us is only asleep. It is not dead. When opportunities come, it jumps up and, as of old, uses its claws and fangs. Apart from the sword, apart from the material weapons, there are weapons still more terrible: contempt, social hatred, and social ostracism. Now, these are the most terrible of all inflictions that are hurled against persons who do not think exactly in the same way as we do. And why should everybody think just as we do? I do not see any reason. If I am a rational man, I should be glad that they do not think just as I do. I do not want to live in a grave like land. I want to be a man in a world of men. Thinking beings must differ. Difference is the first sign of thought. If I am a thoughtful man, certainly I ought to like to live amongst thoughtful persons, where there are differences of opinion. Then arises the question, how can all these varieties be true? If one thing is true, its negation is false. How can contradictory opinions be true at the same time? This is the question which I intend to answer. But I will first ask you, are all the religions of the world really contradictory? I do not mean the external forms in which great thoughts are clad. I do not mean the different buildings, languages, rituals, books, etc., employed in various religions. But I mean the internal soul of every religion. Every religion has a soul behind it, and that soul may differ from the soul of another religion. But are they contradictory? Do they contradict or supplement each other? That is the question. I took up the question when I was quite a boy and have been studying it all my life. Thinking that my conclusion may be of some help to you, I place it before you. I believe that they are not contradictory. They are supplementary. Each religion, as it were, takes up one part of that great universal truth and spends its whole force into embodying and typifying that part of the great truth. It is therefore addition, not exclusion. That is the idea. System after system arises, each one embodying a great idea. And ideals must be added to ideals. And this is the march of humanity. Man never progresses from error to truth, but from truth to truth, from lesser truth to higher truth. But it is never from error to truth. The child may develop more than the father, but was the father inane? The child is the father plus something else. If your present state of knowledge is much greater than it was when you were a child, would you look down upon that stage now? Will you look back and call it inanity? Why, your present stage is the knowledge of the child plus something more. Then again, we also know that there may be almost contradictory points of view of the same thing, but they will all indicate the same thing. Supposing a man is a journey toward the sun, and as he advances, he takes a photograph of the sun at every stage. When he comes back, he has many photographs of the sun, which he places before us. We see that not two are alike, and yet who will deny that all these photographs are of the same sun taken from different standpoints? Take four photographs of this church from different corners. How different they look, and yet they would all represent this church. In the same way, we are all looking at truth from different standpoints, which vary according to our birth, education, surroundings, and so on. We are viewing the truth, getting as much of it as these circumstances will permit it, coloring the truth with our own heart, understanding it with our own intellect, and grasping it with our own mind. We can only know as much of truth as it is related to us, as much of it as we are able to receive. This makes the difference between man and man, and occasions sometimes even contradictory ideas. Yet we all belong to the same great universal truth. My idea, therefore, is that all these religions are different forces in the economy of God, working for the good of mankind, and that not one can become dead, not one can be killed. Just as you cannot kill any force in nature, so also you cannot kill each any one of these spiritual forces. You have seen that each religion is living. From time to time it may retrograde or go forward. At one time it may be shorn of a good many of its trappings. At another time it may be covered with all sorts of trappings. But all the same, the soul is ever there. It can never be lost. The ideal which every religion represents is never lost. And so, every religion is intelligently on the march. And that universal religion, about which philosophers and others have dreamed in every country, already exists. It is there. And as the universal brotherhood of man is already existing, so also is the universal religion. Which of you that have travelled far and wide have not found brothers and sisters in every nation? I have found them all over the world. Brotherhood already exists. Only there are numbers of persons who fail to see this and only upset it by crying for new brotherhoods. Universal religion too is already existing. If the priests and the other people that have been taking upon themselves the task of preaching different religions simply cease preaching for a few moments, we shall see it is there. They are disturbing it all the time because it is to their interest. You see that priests in every country are very conservative. Why is it so? There are very priests who lead the people. Most of them are led by the people and are their slaves and servants. If you say it is dry, they say it is so. And if you say it is black, they say it is black. They cannot lag behind. So blaming the priests, it is a fashion to blame the priest. You ought to, rather, blame yourselves. You only get what you deserve. What would be the fate of a priest who wants to give you new and advanced ideas and lead you forward? His children would probably starve, and he would be clad in rags. He is governed by the same worldly laws as you are. If you go on, he says, let us march. Of course, there are exceptional souls not cowed down by public opinion. They see the truth, and truth alone they value. Truth has got hold of them, has got possession of them as it were, and they cannot but march forward. They never look backward, and for them they are no people. God alone exists for them. He is the light before them, and they are following that light. To be continued.